Good morning, River of Life Church family. This is Matt again here live from my living room this Sunday morning with you. Guys, we are celebrating Palm Sunday this morning. Basically, the King Jesus as the Messiah and as the King riding into Jerusalem and people proclaiming him as King. Would you turn in your Bibles with me this morning to 1 Timothy chapter 1? We're going to be reading just a couple verses here as we come into worship. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 15 through 17. Read along with me. The saying is trustworthy, the Apostle Paul says to a young pastor, Timothy. This saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But I received mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who will believe in him for eternal life. And verse 17 says, to the King of the ages, King Jesus, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's lift our voices this morning as we sing to the only King forever, Jesus Christ.
Our God, firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. Yeah, we trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Sing unmatched in all your wisdom.
Unmatched in all your wisdom. In love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus.
Yes, Jesus.
Oh, we trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Yeah. Ooh.
Let's sing to our King Jesus. Let's sing, we lift his banner high.
We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high, we lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Yeah.
Welcome, everybody. It's Palm Sunday. Good morning. We're glad you're with us here to worship together. As we are together around this video and you in your living rooms and different places where you're watching this video, we can't do what we normally would do on a Palm Sunday when we're together. But you know what we're after today? We're after meaning. And that's what we really want to go for here today. How can we make this Easter season a time of meaning in our walk with Christ? Well, really, that should always be our goal. And today we're going to celebrate Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry. We're going to worship together. We're going to stay in our series in Peter, where we discover that the cross is where Jesus was always intended to go, even if the disciples were confused and it didn't make sense. And we find that what Jesus went through is what he asks us to go through, obedience to the Father's will, and death so that we can find life. And we're going to end today by taking communion together. And so if you haven't yet prepared juice and bread for communion, please just take a moment, pause this video, and go get those things ready. Why don't we pray together as we prepare for this morning, and then we'll continue in worship through song. Heavenly Father, we pray that as we're together around in our living rooms and around TV sets and devices this morning, though we're separated because of this pandemic, Lord, I pray that you'd bring us together, one in the Spirit, one around Christ, that we might worship and glorify you. Father, do a work in our hearts this morning. Prepare us for that. Tenderize us for that. You are worthy of all of our worship. You're worthy of all of our praise. We thank you that today we can celebrate Palm Sunday, this day that marks the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. As people proclaimed, Hosanna, glory to God in the highest. They proclaimed their joy in you. Father, I pray that today would be a proclamation of our joy in you as we do all of these things, worshiping you together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, as we come back together and as we lift our voices in worship, may we see Jesus high and lifted up as our King. May we lift our eyes to him this morning and lift our voices. Sing praises rising. Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning. We long for you, Lord Jesus, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, they're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. Yeah, you are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Yeah, come Emmanuel among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. Yes, Lord. You make us new. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day.
Yes, we do. Cause in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna. Hosanna. Yeah, you're the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Hosanna. Welcome everywhere among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Yeah. We see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. So when we see you, Lord, when we see you, we find strength to face the day. We look to you every day, Lord. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hey. Hosanna, Hosanna. Yeah, you're the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Yeah, come anywhere among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Yeah, Hosanna, Hosanna. Sing it, Hosanna.
If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn in them to Matthew chapter 16. We're going to begin in verse 21. Last week, we heard Peter declare who Jesus is. Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of God." And in today's text that immediately follows in Matthew chapter 16, we hear of Jesus' work because the two go together. Who he is, the Christ, the Son of God, leads to what he does. And Jesus makes it clear that he has a singular purpose in coming to Jerusalem. And it all points to the cross. If you have your Bibles, you should be in Matthew chapter 16, and I'm going to begin in verse 21. Let's look at this together. And it says this: "From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day, be raised." You know, there's so much to learn about Jesus here. As we do, we also learn about his will for us, our own discipleship. Jesus is surrendered to the Father's will. And like a man headed into battle, a battle that he knew he would choose to lose, yet the victory would be found through what seemed on the surface like a loss. There's a basic discipleship principle here in today's text, and it's this: Jesus never asks us to do what he has not already done himself. What has he done? Well, he submitted his will to the Father's will. And here, Jesus' heart is going to be expressed as it's exposed later in the garden, where Jesus says, "Not my will, but your will be done." Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, has come to die in our place for our sins. In the coming weeks following this text, it would be a hard road for Jesus. It was through suffering that Jesus would receive glory, though. But the intensity of all that started with what we call Palm Sunday, his entrance into Jerusalem. And none of the disciples could really fathom that this man that they had banked their entire lives upon left everything to follow, that he would die. Their picture was of a kingly processional, of the triumphal entry, not as a savior on a cross. And so it didn't make sense to them. But I've asked a few of my kid friends to tell us the story of this triumphal entry, this day that we celebrate today. Let's listen to this.
What did Jesus ride on when he came into Jerusalem?
Donkey. A donkey.
That's right.
Oh, why do you think he rode on a donkey?
Because... to show that the weak ones, if you trust in the Lord, you're strong.
Yeah, to fulfill what the prophet said.
What did the people shout as Jesus came into Jerusalem?
Hosanna!
Hosanna in the highest!
Hosanna!
And why did Jesus go to Jerusalem?
Wasn't it part of the feast?
Passover!
This is Matthew 21, 1-11. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden."
The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkeys and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is who is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee."
Aren't they cute? Thanks, kiddos. We're back in our text that we started with this morning in Matthew chapter 16. None of the disciples could get their heads around what Jesus was telling them would happen, even his entrance into Jerusalem. And as he was saying this, they thought he would be their earthly king. So Peter, our disciple of passion, he speaks up. And in that text in Matthew chapter 16, in the next verse, verse 22, it says, "And Peter took Jesus aside, and he began to rebuke him, saying, 'Far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you.' But Jesus turned, and he said to Peter, 'Get behind me, Satan. You're a hindrance to me. For you're not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man.'" What's wrong with Peter right here? I mean, one minute, Peter's led by God to confess his faith in Jesus Christ, and then the very next minute, he's thinking like an unbelieving man expressing the thoughts of Satan. Does he want to be saved from his sins? I mean, Peter could only see the cross, but he couldn't see through the cross. You see, if Jesus was going to die, Peter, loses everything. Peter left it all to follow Jesus. And now what? So this is how it's going to end? Well, Peter's protest, it was probably born partly out of just some ignorance of God's will and what God was doing, and also at the same time, this deep love and passion for his Lord. One minute, he's the rock, Peter, the rock, and the next minute, he's a stumbling block to Jesus. But Peter was thinking earthly because it makes sense to him, and he just didn't understand. Like a man who does that without the wisdom of the Lord, without insight of what heaven is doing. And because of this limited insight, he wants to block God's will. And the disciples have been called to follow Jesus, and they knew that whatever happened to Jesus would also happen to them. Well, the Old Testament certainly talked of the Messiah suffering, but more of his glory. So how could their Messiah possibly be rejected and executed? If there was a cross in Jesus' future, there would be a cross in their future too. They're finding out that there's a price to pay for true discipleship. And so Jesus, in that moment, as we just read, he rebukes Peter. It's like a football play where the coach, Father in heaven, calls the play. And Jesus listens to the coach. He submits to the coach and he executes the play. And Peter, who's supposed to be on the team with Jesus, he goes and he tries to tackle his own player. But Jesus, he stiff arms him as Peter attempts to take control of the situation. The rebuke that Jesus gave to Peter is a harsh rebuke. It's a hard rebuke. In fact, it's the same word that is used of Jesus when he rebuked the demons. Peter's put in his place in that moment. And it's time for God's will and for the Father's will. Well, what does this all have to do with Peter's discipleship? Well, the disciples must surrender to the Father's will. The rock has now become the stumbling block because of this. Believers who are not submitted to the will of heaven actually become a tool of the enemy. I mean, think about this. In everyday life, we fight God all the time, disagreeing with his word, or at least we read it and then we walk away from it, not obeying it, or ignoring his promptings, or setting our own direction for life. Even in the church, sometimes with good intention, maybe even we're right, but we take our opinions or our thoughts and we end up tearing people down and causing harm. Or we can be divisive in the church, God's plan. Or we can gossip against other people. See what I mean? I can be a believer and yet still be used as a tool of the enemy when I sin like this. In this time we're living in, think of it in this context. Have you ever considered what does God want to do in you right now? In some ways, what he wants to do in his church. See, I believe he's refining us, refining his church. I think he's refining us as individuals. Right now, how does he want to pull us in? Are we asking the questions, God, what is your will in all of this? What are you up to here? But the mission of God is to give life as we die to ourselves. See, we have a tendency to argue with God, rejecting his word, rejecting his direction. And often it's based on and comes out in our making of decisions and how we live. And we live from our limited perspective and we do what we think makes sense to us, but it's not necessarily the will of God. And when we do that, we actually become a tool of Satan. When we argue with God's word, we open up the door to Satan's lies. But will you surrender your will to God? Even when obeying him or trusting him doesn't make any sense. You see, that's a major step for a disciple. It's a part of our growth as a disciple. It's a turning point. When we say, not my will, but your will be done. It's one of those deaths that God calls us to, a death to self, death to my desires. And Peter was on, at this moment, the front end of learning that there's a connection between suffering and glory. And that lesson began here. But once he did make this decision? Once he began to say, God, I want your will, it was as if God opened a whole new level of his discipleship. When God does that in us, when we submit our will to him, here's the good news, is that he equips us in that. He never asks us to do what he has not done himself. Where Jesus goes, he calls us to follow. And he died that we might die, and he rose to life that we might have life. And when we die to self, we take up our cross, this topic that we're going to dive deeply into in just 2 weeks. But the good news is he equips us for it. Obedience doesn't come from your will. It comes from you and I walking in the Spirit. You don't obey to get God's love, but you obey because he already loves you. You have the Spirit in you. And so my question to you today is, would you be willing on this Palm Sunday to settle it today? To say, you know what? I want to make a change in my life. Not my will, but God, instead, your will be done. Even on an ongoing basis, that's a call, a prayer of a disciple. And so have you been fighting God in your life? Maybe resisting his work in your life, fighting his plan in your life. What does he want to do in your life, even during this pandemic that we're walking through? Is there an area of your life that is in secret or just outright rebellion? My question for you today is, would you be willing to make a trade today to hand him your will and in place receive his will? And say, I want, God, what you want. Just as Jesus desired what the Father wanted. This morning, one of the neat things we're going to do, maybe for the very first time for some of you, is take communion together as we celebrate the Lord's death and resurrection and the salvation that was won for us through that. And on this Palm Sunday, what a neat day for us to do that from our homes, but yet together taking communion. Celebrating this triumphant moment of the resurrection of Christ and the new life he gives us. But what an awesome step it would be for us in this moment, as we come around communion together, to say to God, I want your will. You did what the Father wanted. You gave up your very life, and I today want to die to myself and live for you. You hopefully have prepared some elements for you and your family as you're together watching this video. And I want to lead us in that communion time. And so get those out and have those in front of you. I have mine, some bread and some juice in front of me, just symbols of Christ's body and his blood, both of which are shed, body broken for us, blood shed for us. Both of these things, simply symbols. They're not actually his body, not actually his blood, but they help us remember the significance of the cross. You might remember the words of Jesus in the upper room just a few weeks after this text in Matthew 16. And in the midst of this, Jesus had his disciples together, and the scripture tells us when Jesus had given thanks, he broke the bread and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. You hopefully are holding the bread in your hand right now, and I just would encourage you to be quiet for just a moment, examine yourself, and then we'll take this together in just a second. Let's pray silently where we're at. Father, we thank you for your body, which was literally broken for us. And Lord, I pray that as we take this communion, you would hear our prayers. We understand our salvation and our forgiveness only comes through you, Jesus, because of what you went through. So we take this bread knowing that it came at great cost. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take that together. Well, the scripture tells us that in the same way, also he took the cup. cup after supper. And he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Remember, blood symbolizes life. The idea that he shed his life that we could have life. Let's take this cup in remembrance of Christ. Lord Jesus, we praise you. We have so much to praise you for because you gave up your whole life that we would have life in you. Spiritual life, new life. And so Lord, today as we come around the communion table, part of what we're saying to you is not our will, but your will be done. And in that we know that that's a difficult thing, that there's actually a death, a suffering going on inside as we die to self. And we ask you to live within us, that your spirit would rule and reign us. But God, we thank you that you paid the penalty for our sins on that cross, that we can have life through you, and your will can be carried out through us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
It's such an honor and pleasure this morning to take communion with the body of Christ. As we consider Jesus, his body broken for us, his blood shed for us, Jesus, we praise you. Would you lift your voices this morning as we close in song? Let's sing about Jesus being our living hope. How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages sent down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. 'Cause Jesus, yours is the victory. Whoa. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Jesus, we praise you that you're our living hope. And all of God's kids said, all of his children said, amen.
Well, church, thank you for being with us this morning. Thank you for worshiping with us. As you go from here, we have just three simple steps that we would like you to take. First of all, go to our website, riveroflifegj.com. Click on the Watch Sunday Video tab at the top. From there, you'll find the discussion questions. Download those and just take a few minutes with your family to read through those questions. Second, would you, on that same page, click on the tab that says Holy Week Reading Plan. And this week, we would love for our church family to read through these verses together each day from today, Palm Sunday, right on through Easter Sunday. After each day's reading, we'll have a devotional from our staff and elders posted on the Facebook page and the Instagram page. And then finally, step number three, the last one, would you on that same page also download the page that says five great meaningful ideas for Good Friday? And from that, pick something that will help you guide your family in a very meaningful Good Friday this coming week. Thanks for being with us. Join us again next Sunday, Easter Sunday, as we celebrate together.